Boys and girls of the shaft! Boy, oh boy! Over the last few days, we've had the opportunity to see a lot of aberration. Hoo-wee! It sure does look good, doesn't it? Too bad we still don't have it! Anyway, there's been a lot of streams on the aberration demo, and we've learned a lot of new things about this very exciting DLC. So rather than make you dig through everything, we're gonna go ahead and compile a list of the top 10 things you need to know about aberration! Let's get right into it! Coming in at number 10, transfers! So you're prepping yourself, getting hyped for aberration. You've got all your fave dinos locked and loaded, ready to be moved to this new map. But wait, not so fast! If you thought you were gonna be able to transfer creatures back and forth willy-nilly, well, you were wrong! You'll be able to transfer dinos out of aberration, but not into aberration. So you'll kind of have to be starting from zero. Sort of. You'll still be able to transfer items into and out of aberration, though. For example, you'll be able to take pickaxes and gliders out of aberration and into the island. Number 9! Stay out of the sunlight! So check it out. We already know that sunlight is radioactive and bad, 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 nasty stuff. But did you know structures will be damaged if they're sitting in direct sunlight? Now, it's not clear if there's any structures that are gonna be impervious to the effects of sunlight, or if sunlight will eradicate everything in its path. And it's also not clear how long your structures will be standing for either. I assume that if you choose to build in the sunlight, you're gonna be spending a lot of time fixing up your base. You will be able to build in areas where there is direct sunlight, but you'll have to find little caverns and little land masses and land bridges to build under that aren't exposed to the sunlight. So I'm assuming that these building places are gonna be very competitive. Coming in at number 8, resources, new and old. So check it out. We probably already have seen this before, all of us as a collective whole, because we all at least saw that first stream. There's gonna be new items like mushrooms, gems, charge, and gas. Mushrooms, you can eat them, and I assume they're gonna be for taming things. And the mushrooms give you psychedelic effects. You got 3 kinds of gems, which are a new resource to aberration, which will be used to craft various items. Then you've got charge, we'll talk more about that soon. And gas. Gas is pretty interesting. It's not clear what exactly gas is gonna be used for. Maybe it's gonna be used for powering, like, I don't know, gas-powered harpoon guns. Who knows? The thing about it, though, is gas is collected using gas collectors. And there's gonna be these gas leaks you find around aberration, and you'll be able to place your gas collectors on them, much like the oil refinery in Scorched Earth. Here's the kicker, though. What the devs wanted to do was they wanted to make it not like Scorched Earth, where you could just stick a gas collector there and then just let it passively farm for you while you sleep forever. The thing is, the gas leaks will run out at some point. Your gas collector will stop collecting gas, which is gonna require you to go find another gas leak. So you're gonna be on the move a lot. You will also be able to collect tech element without having to fight bosses. Finally, number 7, map size. Oh, map size. It kind of makes sense now why they pushed it back, but I'm still not happy about it. This is the largest map ever. At least the largest official wildcard map ever. It's about the size of Scorched Earth, but what makes it the biggest map ever? What makes it the biggest map ever is the fact that, yes, it's, what, horizontally about as big as Scorched Earth, but what about vertically? It has all kinds of caverns and things that go down and up. You have the whole surface biome, you have the below surface biome, and I assume the below surface biomes. So in total, it's like having Scorched Earth, but it's like vertically stacked. So this is actually surprisingly gonna be a huge map. I thought that this was gonna be a tiny little baby map, smaller than Scorched Earth, but no, this is actually gonna be the biggest thing. Coming in at number 6, charge. Now, I said I was gonna talk about this, and now we're gonna talk about it. So, oh my goodness, there's a lot to talk about here. Charge. Charge is gonna be a resource in aberration that is gonna be absolutely critical to just about everything you do. Absolutely critical to survival, and it's gonna be critical to being able to just function in general in aberration. It's gonna be that universal resource that everything takes. Charge is gonna be used by items, creatures, and even weapons. It's gonna be used everywhere. You'll be able to use charge to power, or rather, you'll be able to use charge to recharge batteries, which can then be slapped in new and old electrical stuff for your convenience. And this is where we gotta talk about a bit of a new creature, guys. So there's these insects, these bugs that fly around the map called light bugs. They're a lot like jug bugs. You walk up to them, and either you or your lantern pet can collect the charge from these light bugs. It's not clear how else you're gonna be able to collect charge, but there's gotta be some other way. Otherwise, people are gonna be making a mad dash for these bugs, and it's gonna be pretty hectic and chaotic. Maybe there's gonna be something later on in game where you can stick like solar panels on the surface biome or something. Who knows? And while we're on the topic of charge, let's talk about light. Charge powers light, right? Yeah, that makes sense. Well, all creatures are gonna react differently to charge and to light, which is powered by charge. Some creatures are gonna be buffed and empowered by it, and some creatures like the Reapers are gonna be weakened by it. So that's something to keep in mind. Always carry with you something that possesses the might of charge. Number 5! Everything we know about the Rock Drake so far! Alright! We've already seen this guy 100 million billion trillion times since that first trailer. We've already talked about him in my last top 10, which you should go check out if you haven't already seen it. But there's more to talk about, guys! This is probably the creature we know the absolute most about. And now we know even more. So obviously, we already know that the Rock Drake has the ability to climb on all surfaces and even go upside down. We know that it can glide and boost. We know that it can go invisible. We know this stuff. Well, what we learned over the last couple of days is that the Rock Drake is also gonna have a dive bomb attack similar to the Griffin. We now know what its little crest feathers do. Remember, I mentioned this. What do its crest feathers do? Well, it's not a light. What the crest feathers do is the Rock Drake is the natural predator of the Reapers. So the Reapers are the little chupacabra things that you see running around. Well, the Rock Drake is the natural predator of those, and it gets excited. It gets all worked up when it smells one of them. It's like one of those creepy stalkers, man. It is a stalker, actually. Oh my gosh, it goes invisible. It stalks these little chupacabras, man! That's creepy! Anyway, it stalks the little chupacabras, and its crest feathers perk up. It's excited. You know, its little crest feathers get erect because it's excited, right? Anyway, this will be useful for detecting when those little baddies are in the area. And I'm assuming that the Rock Drake, based on the fact that it is the natural predator, is going to be buffed against the Reapers and against the Reaper itself. Another thing that we learned is that the Rock Drake is going to be found in its own sort of trench, much like the wyverns are in Scorched Earth. So that's something to bear in mind. Rock Drakes are going to spawn in a specific area. When Rock Drakes go invisible, the invisibility uses stamina. So that's something to bear in mind. You're going to need to keep an eye on your stamina gauge. If you want to stay invisible longer, you're going to want to pump points into stamina. And God help you if you run out of stamina while you're climbing upside down on some rock or something. Number 4, the Reaper King! So, some of you thought I was wrong, huh? You thought there wasn't a Reaper King? You saw my video and you were like, nah, bro, that ain't no Reaper King, that's the Reaper Queen! Or Nameless King, or Nameless Queen, as we called them up till now. They're now the Reapers. But you thought I was wrong? Well, you were wrong! Because it turns out there is a Reaper King. Boom! Nailed it! So here's the deal. The Reaper King is much like the Reaper Queen, but a bit of a weaker version. The Reaper King, we don't know a ton about the Reaper King, but we do know it exists. And what we do know is that the Reaper King is summoned by the smaller, lesser Reapers. And you need to be really careful, because what'll happen is if one Reaper catches you, they'll all start swarming on you like a bunch of rats. And next thing you know, if you get 10 or more grouped up together, they'll summon the dreaded Reaper King. And then you've got a real problem. So that's... this kind of again plays into the whole theme of aberration, where you gotta constantly be moving around. The devs don't want you sitting in one place for too long, and if you do sit in one place for too long, you're in trouble, because this guy's gonna find you. The Reaper King will have the ability to spit poison at you, which will cause a new status effect called acid burn. So you're gonna need to be very careful, and the only way to avoid acid burn is by wearing a hazmat suit. Number 3! Tech, sleeping pods, and more! Whew. So, tech sleeping pods. What in the world is a tech sleeping pod, man? Well, tech sleeping pod is kind of the next evolution of beds, right? So we had our primitive beds, we had our not primitive beds, the bunk beds, but what comes after the bunk bed? There needed to be a new tier, right? Of course. We need a tech sleeping pod. So the tech sleeping pod is gonna work kind of like the chair in other games, where you're gonna be able to just rest in the tech sleeping pod, and what it will do is it'll regenerate your health, stamina, food, water, and there's an extra benefit. While you're laying in the tech pod, it'll also give you an XP boost. So this is gonna be great. Rather than logging off at night, you can just go ahead and go AFK in the tech pod, let your tribe mates go off and work, and you can basically just leech XP. Great. I also wanted to use this section to talk about some other new and exciting items. The tech sleeping pod is kind of the coolest one, but there's some other stuff that's pretty cool too. We learned a bit more about the zipline. To power the zipline, you're gonna need a zipline motor, and the zipline motor runs on gasoline and probably other sources of power as well. There's a little bit more about the hazmat suit that you should know. The hazmat suit, obviously, as we all know, protects from the elements like the radioactive sunlight. The hazmat suit is also gonna protect from acid burn, like I just said, gas leaks, and even, check this out, even gas grenades. Thank goodness. Ugh. So it's gonna be kind of like a gas mask that you can just wear forever. So this is, I mean, they just made the gas mask irrelevant with this item. There's also gonna be a fish basket, which will work like a fishing net. It'll be able to capture fish, which will make it easier to hunt, tame, or even transport your little fishy friends. Coming in at number 2! What we know about the creature so far! There's still much about aberration that we don't know, but during these streams, we've had the opportunity to learn a lot more about the creatures than these boring old torn up dossiers tell us. We even got the opportunity to see some new creatures that haven't been talked about yet. Now, normal creatures, as we already talked about earlier, are not gonna be transferable to aberration. There's going to be normal creatures in aberration though. As you would expect, there's only 12 new creatures to aberration, so they're gonna have old dinos. But here's the thing, the old dinos that have made their way into aberration are gonna be transferable to the Ark. And here's the thing that's really cool. They glow in the dark, man! They glow in the dark! There's aberration versions of all the old dinos in aberration, or at least the old ones that made it in aberration. There's aberrant versions. So these are weird mutated creatures that glow in the dark. It doesn't really mean much else other than they look really cool and you'll be able to ride around and swag on your slick-looking parasaur on the island and make all the kids jealous. Oh yeah, and remember what I said about the lantern pets earlier? I did mention that earlier, right? Well, if I didn't, we're talking about it now. So the lantern pets. The lantern pets are a set of 4 super cute creatures in aberration. We don't know everything about them, at least we have the names, and I believe we've at least seen one more, other than the bulb dog. You've got the bulb dog, Feather Light, Shinehorn, and the Glow Tail. They all give off light and they all use charge, and they all have a different quality. What this means isn't so clear. It could be that maybe the Shinehorn is better than the Bulb Dog. Maybe it has a greater radius of light. Maybe a consequence of the lantern pets that give off a greater radius of light is that they use more charge or something. We don't know. They're all going to have their own special way of functioning in the game. Let's talk about the crab real quick. The crab is pretty cool. We've seen it already. The crab, at least in the trailer, could grab things, throw them, and that was about all we saw. Well, we learned a bit more. The left click is going to be the standard attack, you know, just like a claw attack. If you hold left click, and this is a little bit different from how any other dinos have worked in the game so far. If you hold left click, the crab is going to be able to grab things. In addition, the crab has a big ol' leap, which makes it good for getting around. The leap can be targeted, and it can be used as sort of a tackle. You can tackle into other creatures or players and do a fair bit of damage. And then there's the issue of the Reapers. What we know so far about them? Well, what we know so far is they're not to be trifled with. They might seem like weak little minion creatures, but they get out of hand really quick, and they're actually much stronger than you would think immediately. Obviously, they're weakened by charge, so you're gonna wanna have a lantern pet with you to combat them. And what will happen is you'll find one alpha nameless, rather, Reaper. You'll find one alpha Reaper wandering around, and if that baddie attacks you, what he's gonna do is he's gonna draw a bigger group of nameless to attack you as well. That's where it gets out of hand, and that's where the Reaper King will emerge to ruin your day. And finally, number one, the Reaper Queen. So I know you were sitting there wondering when we were gonna talk about it. We are gonna talk about it, right? Of course we are. And we're gonna throw it in the number one slot because there ain't nothing more exciting than the Reaper Queen. The Reaper Queen is still largely a mystery. We're still missing a lot of information. At least with these streams, we now have more to go off of, though. We still don't know how it's gonna be tamed. We still don't quite know how it spawns. In the demo, the Reaper Queen is just there on the map with a marker, and it's just available as a challenge for people to take on. We don't even know exactly how it impregnates its enemies. What we do know is that the Reaper Queen can impregnate you, though. And in the demo, there's a timer, as you saw at the bottom right of the screen. Once that timer hits zero, hey, your stream time is over, buddy boy, because that little baby Reaper just bursted out of your chest. And it's pretty wild how that works. So the little xenomorph thing, when it bursts through your chest, it doesn't look like a normal Reaper. It looks like some weird small aquatic thing, and then it will transform into a normal Reaper. The Reaper Queen is gonna be comparable to a Giga as far as its stats go, and sadly, like a Giga, once tamed, its stats are also gonna be dropped pretty significantly. It would seem that as far as the Reaper Queen goes, once tamed, you will be able to impregnate enemies just like the wild one can. How that works, again, we don't know. Maybe it's something like it will latch onto a player and then, I don't know, hit them with some kind of gas or something, who knows? Maybe it's another thing that you need the hazmat suit for. And this is again where the lantern pets come in handy. You are absolutely, absolutely never gonna wanna fight the Reaper Queen without a lantern pet or without something that uses charge and gives off light. The Reaper Queen is very, very powerful in the dark. But if the Reaper Queen is in the radius of a lantern pet's light, then it's weakened significantly and is much, much easier to fight. I imagine that the taming process is probably gonna be something like, you need to keep a charge on the Reaper Queen, and then while it's weakened, that's how you're gonna tame it. It's probably not gonna be a standard tame. It could be, but with how things are going in Aberration so far, everything seems to be unorthodox, and it seems to work different than how you would expect. And you know what? I wish I had more. I wish I had more on the Reaper Queen, but that's about all I got for the Reaper Queen, and that's about all I got for this video today. Hey, if you're new here, make sure you bash that subscribe button. We're gonna be talking a lot more about Aberration, and we're gonna be making a lot more videos coming up, so stay tuned. We'll chat next time.